We are joined on our Yeshiva World Newsmaker line by Professor Hershey Friedman, Deputy Chairman of the Business Department of Brooklyn College. He and Assemblyman Dov Hikind have made big news by accusing a provost in Brooklyn College of anti-Semitism, or that's at least the quote from Assemblyman Hikind in a letter that he sent to CUNY. Welcome, and thank you for joining us, Professor Friedman.
Yeah, well, first of all, hi. I didn't really, I don't want to say the word accuse, but I want to say the pattern speaks.
Right, and that is the wording I should quote, pervasive patterns of anti-Semitism.
A pattern, and also some strange remarks that are also, highly inappropriate.
Okay, so let's get right to it. These are obviously very serious accusations.
Mm-hmm.
Please tell us what you know.
Well, first I've been, essentially my Robert Bell and I have been running the department for about 10 years. It used to be one department.
This is the
Brooklyn College. At one time it's called economics, and about a year and a half ago we split into three departments, and then we became a school of business. So right now, technically, there are three departments there. There's accounting, there's economics, and our department is called finance and business management. I'll just call it business, but really it's finance and business management.
Okay.
And so I've been involved in lots and lots and lots of searches, because I've been in the Columbia School, as I mentioned, for about 18, 19 years. So,
And you've been
Robert
in Brooklyn Bell, College, you mentioned earlier to me.
Yeah, I've been there. I was there as a faculty member, I think, 26 years.
26 years, okay.
Something like that. Yeah, I think it's 26 years and about 19 years on the appointments committee. That means all the hiring I'm involved in. It's not me alone. There are five. Usually the appointments committee is five.
But we get
people.
The point. You've seen an awful lot of hiring.
I've seen an awful lot of hiring. If I can go down the list of how many people I've hired. And we never had a problem. In fact, most colleges. My wife is a professor too, so she knows about hiring. And I have the children who are now becoming academics, so I know how hiring works. It's not something new to me. And
okay, so let's get to some specifics. Sir. So Provost William Tramantano, you say has sort of done things differently, and there are several examples here. I noticed in the New York Post. You feel he's been wrong in not hiring religious Jews.
Well, the first case that came up in front of us, this is only one department. We were doing a search for an accountant, and again, I was on the committee, and the person who won the search, her name was Miriam Gerstein, and she's a very, very obviously very frum lady. The Shaitel, and I think she supports her husband who's in Lakewood or something like that.
Right.
But she was really brilliant, and we figured it's a normal search, and we debated this. We had some of the people in the accounting department also came, and we had three candidates. Three good candidates, and in fact, one of the candidates was somebody just for the record. He was African American that I brought into the search. So it's not, that's what we try to do in the searches. We all try to make it what they call diversity. You want to have some diversity at the college, so you try to bring in different kinds of candidates.
Which I'm not sure, I always understand. You would think you'd want the best candidate
regardless
of their race.
For the interviewing. You try to bring them into the pool. The college has a procedure that, I'll tell you what it's called. The college is right that if suddenly you have, let's say, five old men, running a department, suddenly all the interviewees are five old men and all the pool is only old men. Because they just bring in their friends or something. So the college, and this is correct. I mean, again, I don't want you to think I'm this crazy, I'm not that kind of person. I believe in, giving everybody a fair chance.
Great. And, getting back to Miriam Gerstein.
So she got, we had, there was three people I think we interviewed three then. One of them, somebody I brought in, and it turned out right away we knew that it wouldn't be good because he's already he was in the middle of the tenure process at another school, and I asked the guy, I said, why don't you tell us this? Because we can't, bring you in,
right.
When you're in the middle of a tenure, you're going to get tenure in your school. And bottom line is, he himself, he said, he just, I don't know why he even, joined the search. But anyway, we had three. I think it was
and
three.
It says here that you guys decided she was the most qualified
to be
the professor.
She was definitely, because...
Now, is that unequivocal? Is it possible that Mr. Tramantano didn't agree?
I'll tell you what happened is that suddenly we, given that, normally the way it always works in almost every college that I know of is that once the appointments committee selects somebody, that's it. You never hear that somebody's turning down the search. if you did it properly, and we got a woman. By the way, the one time we were told to bring somebody that we kind of underrepresented, you know, we had an underrepresented group, was women.
Uh-huh.
We actually were sued once by a woman.
So you're sort of saying that this is how the decision process works. You guys signed off on her in normal business. That should be it.
That's usually the way
it works. And he overrode her.
And suddenly we get a I'm trying to remember how we got the word. I think it was just an email or something.
Wow.
But and he doesn't even sit down and communicate with us. It's not like, you know, he'd sit down. You know, we put a lot of work into a search. It takes a lot of effort and time, and sometimes you have to bring in people from other states and, you know, not other countries too often.
And he's quoted as saying, "You already have a Miriam." Is that accurate?
That's what happened when we he told us. In fact, it was even scarier because we went to him. Then it was new to us. We never heard of a provost stopping a search. You know, that was done already, completed. We never heard of such a thing.
Uh-huh, interesting. So that right there, you're saying, is not
the way
it's normally
done. We were so shocked because it was so irregular. And to make it even worse, you know, he said, you know, he points, that we showed him the names. I remember we showed him the names. We actually, this was face to face. We showed him the names. He points to a name on the list. And several of us later on reported this to a lawyer that came from City University, sent the lawyer down. And he points to a name, and we said, "Why?" You know, and he said, "Why not this guy?" Actually, that was a fourth person. That was a fourth person we interviewed. We actually interviewed four. You know, so he points to a name, and the only thing that was special about the name was an obviously non-Jewish name. It was a man, yet. It was a man who wasn't Jewish. And we said that we interviewed the guy. He was terrible. He was awful. Basically, as a teacher.
Wow.
I'm not an accountant, but I can tell when somebody's a good teacher or a bad teacher. You can tell.
Right.
This guy we all knew was no good. Every one of us said, no way. So he told me he wasn't good. He said, so clearly he didn't want her. And he wanted somebody else. He didn't know who it was. He pointed to a name. That's why right away we suspected, oh, no.
Now, he's going to tell you, well, that's very maybe unusual way of doing things, but that doesn't make it anti-Semitism.
No, one story alone, and indeed.
Okay.
And then he made that remark. I don't remember if it's that point or later on. You know, but he made a remark, I already gave you a Miriam.
Now, did you hear him say that, by the way?
Yes. Yeah, three or four of us. It wasn't just one of us. Several of us.
And I
guess... reported.
He said, "I already gave you, or you already have in the papers."
I
you already
don't remember.
Have.
I think he said, "I already gave."
Okay,
you.
That's interesting.
I mean, one word. I'm pretty sure the word he said was a gave.
I understand. Now, I guess is it possible he's going to say, "Well, yeah, I was just making a joke because there already is someone named Miriam."
Alone. You know, I would say maybe.
But it's the pattern. I got you. Let's move on here for a second. I'm sorry to interrupt you. I read this somewhere that somebody he actually referred to as rabbi.
Yes, this is what we were told. I didn't hear myself, but somebody in the college told me that there was somebody, one of the chairs, I mentioned the story to somebody who was a chair in another department, and said, he once referred to this guy as somebody who's very active in the college. He wears a yarmulke. He's not a rabbi, but he's a yarmulke.
I understand.
And, you know, and he called him, and he has like a...
We can all picture the scene.
Yeah, so he called, you know, behind his back, he said, oh, he called him, he referred to him as the rabbi in front of a bunch of people.
Wow, that's very difficult to defend.
Well, you know, the only thing I could say is maybe he just doesn't understand that these are ethnically insensitive remarks. You know, it just, you know...
Yeah, but you imagine if it were an African-American he were saying it about, oh, would there be an uproar? I mean, you'd have Al Sharpton protesting left and right. So that I can imagine can be pretty offensive. All right, Leo, well, let's move on. Tell us some other examples so we get the pattern.
Then we had another search. Now, this time it was a search for in our area in business to try to find the market. Now, you have to remember the salaries in business are super high because it's a big demand. In fact, in some colleges, somebody with a PhD in business, like in marketing, you know, even a couple of years ago, it was commanding $90,000 or $100,000. We were told we had to hire at a much lower salary. So, we're used to this already. This has been going on, since I'm on the appointments committee, for 19 years. What we've been doing when we have to hire a business person is we know we can't pay the salary that, let's say, Baruch pays. My wife said Baruch, and she told me they were paying $100,000 in marketing and in certain areas, high-demand areas. So, you know, we were paying 60 or 70. In fact, this ad, the search that we were doing, you know, was, I think we were told 70 was going to be something in the low 70s. So what we've done, and indeed we've hired many people this way, we hire people from related areas. In fact, the ad even said clearly, because I wrote the ad, It said, you know, PhD in a related area, and we'd, you know, let, you know, get the word out. And the person that we selected was somebody we all impressed with, super impressed, because she had, you know, 15 publications. It's true her PhD was in psych, but we have psych. In fact, the most published person in the college is in my department. His PhD is in psychology.
Wow.
He publishes 5% of all articles. His name is Fogel. He publishes 5% of, I think, of all the refereed articles. He does it itself. And that's what we, you know, we said this. Here's another Fogel, somebody who can publish a huge number of articles, and she's amazing, and a woman, too. And, you know, we've been told that we have very few women in this. You know, well, now it's the School of Business, and I don't recall if it's the School of Business yet. I don't think so. So, and again, you know, in fact, an email, he doesn't sit down and talk with people. That's one of his problems, is Tramantano just, he'll send you an email, and it's very, sometimes it'll have a snide remark. This one had the one. Something about there's too much religion in her, this
wow.
woman.
Wow.
Yes. Now, look, there was religion in her resume. There was stuff, because she was a, she had a PhD in psych, and then she did a postdoc in chaplaincy. She had a postdoc in chaplaincy. She wrote a lot of articles about being a chaplain and doing work in hospitals and that's the kind of stuff she was doing. And we were very impressed. Remember, our public school is not very Jewish. You know, I'm the frum one there, and the other, there's another person that I didn't, you know, barely, doesn't know very much, but he's Jewish, is Bell himself. He's culturally Jewish. And the other is two Catholic, and one is, I don't even know what he is.
Okay.
He's Japanese. I don't know what it is. I have no idea. I don't want to even
right.
guess.
Right.
It wouldn't be fair.
Okay, but you're saying, you know, it's not like there was an inordinate amount of Jews.
No. Our decisions are not based on religion. In fact, we never talk about religion. That's what really is very annoying to all of us. And now religion, in the last year or so, every conversation with hiring. So anyway, you know, we selected her, and I'll just give you her first name is Nava. And suddenly we get this email about the religion part, and we try to talk to the provost. In fact, Bell called him and said, you know, the appointments committee is very impressed with her.
It says here that you rated her, quote, head and shoulders above the other finalists.
Yeah, I think we all said that she's amazing. She has, I think, you know, a huge number of publications.
And did he specifically cite religion?
He used the word, I think, religion in the email, but he didn't say in that sense there's too much religion on her. Something.
Do you have a copy of that email?
I think he even said she belongs in a religion studies department, something like that.
Is there a copy of that email available?
I don't know.
Okay, I think that would be
very
interesting.
I was listening to that effect. And again, you know, we try to... Bell
That's
try
incredible.
To convince him. Yeah, Bell tried to convince her. Now, he could also email, he meant that she has a lot of these articles that deal with religion. We said she's a psych major, and we have other psych people. By the way, in our department, we have, I think, two or three psych people, two or three sociologists, you know. So, you know, it's not unusual in our department. We have two or three people with degrees in poli-sci, but they're all publishing and business. That's... He had another argument, and we actually did meet with him face to face, and I'm trying to remember when that meeting took place. I remember it was like a year and a half, 2 years ago. But this is a remark also. It got me very upset. You know, I was with Bell, and he's on the phone with him, and he said, you know, this stuff that she does, and you know, she goes to hospitals and everything. That makes her even more attractive to our committee because she's a very ethical person. She does look. We said this makes us, you know, stronger because we're very, you know, we want to teach ethics in business courses.
Right.
So he said at Brooklyn College, this is what he told Bell, at Brooklyn College, we teach ethics. We don't practice it.
Wow. Ooh.
This is what
he said
on the
phone. Very interesting. Now, we're a little bit short on time. Just to sum up the point here is we see, I guess, repeated instance of him mentioning and invoking religion in hiring. We see him overriding who you have decided to hire, which is unusual. And we see at least several quotes.
And the last search was done by the last search was, in a sense, was the worst because that was it wasn't done by us. It was done by the accounting. Now accounting is its own department, and they did the search the proper way, and they had. Remember, you can't even interview. I just want you to know the procedure. You cannot interview anyone until you have approval from the diversity office. They have to make sure that you have this, they look at the pool. They look at the pool, and they ask you why you want to interview. You have to explain why you're interviewing these particular people. So it was approved. And, in fact, there was somebody they wanted to put in, I was told, and they were told no, because that guy doesn't, he's not in a PhD program, and we need somebody who's either in a PhD program or has a PhD in accounting because we want to go for this accreditation. This AACSP accreditation, which requires, you know, we have, you know, we need more PhDs in,
right,
in accounting to get that accreditation. You know, we only have two out of, I think, 13, 14. It's too few. We're very low on that number. So any event, you know,
so what did he do?
So the search, now they did the search, and they had three people, and they had, again, they had diversity in the pool, and one guy didn't speak English well. They said he can't teach accounting. He had a PhD in accounting, but his English was terrible, so they couldn't take him. And then this guy, Dove, was...
Fisher.
It was very good. They loved him. They said he's very good and qualified, and he has a PhD from a...
And so,
you know,
sorry, I don't mean to cut you short, but what? So what exactly happened?
Again, the provost, didn't go, it went to, you know, the way it works is after you do the search, you send the resumes to the diversity offices. You make sure that the reasoning is clear, and then it goes to the provost. Now, the provost had the three resumes. That's why the college is not telling the truth. He had all the resumes, and he said he wants to see letters of recommendation, because Dole was the recommended candidate. So he says, I want to see the letters of recommendation. It wasn't there at the time. So Dole was told to send it in. As he was sending it in, everyone thought, search is over, it's done. And suddenly again, with this, and now somebody from the diversity office suddenly says, oh, something was done wrong in this search. And they had to prove it in two steps, two stages that it was approved. And suddenly now they're saying there was something wrong. That's why everyone suspects that, again, the provost is behind it.
Okay, even though that, you know,
He had all the resumes because he was asking for the letters of recommendation.
So what did they do?
Yeah.
So he was denied because of that?
Yeah, they said that the search. This is what the people in the accounting department were told, that there was something that was done that was improper. I think the argument was that one of the people they interviewed was too far away from the PhD. You know, the ad said PhD preferred. It didn't say, you know, that.
So they found like a technicality.
They found, you know, if you look very hard, you're going to find it's, you know, you can look at everything. That's why you have to burn a get, because if you study it too hard,
right,
you may find something wrong.
Okay,
it's every document.
I get your point. Yeah, definitely very suspicious. Now, before I let you go, people are going to wonder, you know, is it possible they're going to just say, well, yeah, this person wasn't qualified for this reason and that person for that reason. You know, how easy is it to prove? And again, I hear the suspicions. But bottom line, can't they point to each instance and say, well, I had a valid reason here and a valid reason there?
I'm sure they're going to say that. But, you know, again, why is the provost – I tell you, I spoke to somebody from another department. They never in their whole history ever had a provost, negate a search.
Uh-huh. Okay,
you know,
that's
it's never happened. This is not a normal thing. And it had to happen – so that it happens three times, and all three involve, you know, from people. It's just
right.
As a statistic.
And that's my – yeah, right. I understand what you're saying.
You know,
statistically,
it's not unusual to
highly unusual.
A house to burn down. But, you know, if you buy a house, you know, three houses, and all three burn down, we'd ask you, what's going on here?
And that's the last question. Are you aware of any similar issues that have arisen with this provost with non-Jews?
No. In fact, we did hire in our department non-Jews. And this, you know, never a problem. There was one issue that came up with, you know, he's involved also in promotion and tenure. He's supposed to be the president, but we know he makes the decisions. Because, you know, again, there's a procedure where the chairs vote, and but he disregarded the vote of the chairs. He turned down a few people for promotion. And one of them was somebody on our appointments committee. Her name is Carol Connell. And she's a superstar. We knew this. And everyone in the department said, she's the best of your candidates for full professor. And she was turned down. And she herself filed a complaint, and I supported it, and so did Bell, that there had to be some kind of retaliation because of one of these searches, that she supported the candidate we selected, Navid, so that we suspect that he was retaliating. So that's another issue that eventually the president overturned it. In theory, she's the one who does it, but, you know, we know that she's letting the provost do this work. She says to everyone. So, you know, again, she denied this woman a promotion, and everyone knew she deserved it. And she gave it to somebody much weaker, much, much weaker. That's why I even showed the attorneys that the CUNY had some lawyer looking. I showed the CUNY lawyer, there's no way in the world that Carol was weaker than the person that the provost approved, provost president.
Gotcha.
It has to be some kind of retaliation, or they're both just stupid.
Wow.
There's so much more going on. I mean, I just take a three-hour interview.
Right, we're going to have to leave it there. I'm sorry, yeah. We don't have the time to do that. But I will tell you, you've made an absolutely compelling case here.
Yeah.
Very, very suspicious sounding. And we hope that a lot of the facts do emerge over the coming weeks. We appreciate the fact that everybody is out there working on this. We hope that we're helping you here as well.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And we wish you a lot of luck in Atzlocha. Yeah,
thank you very much. And
Professor,
have a good day.
Okay, thank you. You too, Professor Hershey Friedman.
Yeah.
Deputy Chairman of the Business Department of Brooklyn College with Jake Stern on Yeshiva World News.
Take care. Bye-bye.